is a conversation with the mayor, and of course the mayor is Joe Flaherty. Joe, you've been a mayor now for what, two terms?
I'm in my third term right now.
Third term.
So this is actually my fifth year of being the mayor of Moundsview. It just keeps getting
better. Council member before that.
Yeah, and I was a council member for 4 years before that, so I'm in my ninth year of service to the city of Moundsview.
And you enjoy it.
I do. It is so nice getting an understanding of what it takes to run a city, the little ins and outs on you know, what it takes. And probably the best part is to meet the residents, and you know, I'll go to our local stores and that, and they'll come up to me and they'll, hey, I know you, and that's kind of nice to get that recognition. So I'm still enjoying it. I am still enjoying it very much.
That's very good. Yeah. I know, and it is nice so that, you know, when you're into it and knowing that you're able to help them is really, I think, the whole thing about it. People give politicians somewhat a really bad rap.
And
on the city level, you can do it just because you enjoy helping and you don't put your finger up in the air, am I going to get elected again or not? You do what's best for a city.
Absolutely. And that is supposed to be your guiding light, at least in my eyes.
That's what I feel too.
What can I do for this city? How can I help this city?
Yeah.
And the nice thing about being at this level of government is that you can affect so many people, or you can infect you can affect an individual person. You know, it's nice that the people can come up and say, you know, Joe, I've got this issue or that issue, and they know that it'll get looked into. It was very nice. I had a resident the other day that emailed me, and she is working on her master's program in city government, and she had a quick survey that she asked me to fill out to get my view in that, and I filled it out and sent it back to her, and she wrote a real nice letter back to me and said, you know, thank you. You're the first elected official that's responded to my request in that. But that's what you were supposed to do.
I know it is. So. And I think government it's all local.
Yeah.
And you can see things being done from A to Z.
Absolutely.
And you don't need to wait 10 years. Although we're on street reconstruction.
So
how many more years do we have left? Because we're now into...
We're in Area F.
Yeah.
And we have three more project areas to do. Now, we are going to be combining areas G and H together. And then so 2015 should be our last project area.
2015? That's only 2 years from now.
Absolutely.
So it's been moving along very quickly.
It's been great. You know, we were able to... By the savings that we've had because of the economy and our bid processes and that, we were able to combine areas B and C, and we're going to be able to combine areas G and H also. You know, that way we get done quicker, bigger bang for our dollar, and you know, we're just so proud of it. It's the largest monetary project that the city has ever taken on in its history since 1958. So we're pretty proud of that, and hopefully the citizens are pretty proud of it. All the feedback I get on somebody that gets their street done, it's been nothing but positive.
What have they said about the gathering of the mailboxes in one local area, though? Has that been any situation?
No, it hasn't. A minor inconvenience. And as a matter of fact, it's kind of nice because I've had residents say, you know, I get a chance to meet some of my neighbors I've never met before, and they'll meet at this mailbox grouping area, and perhaps, you know, strike up a relationship or a friendship.
Mm-hmm.
But I really haven't. It's a minor inconvenience for what they get in the end, and that is a beautiful street in front of their home and their neighborhood. So.
Well, it was well done in the fact that people didn't have to have the fear of losing a lot of their trees. We kept the roads at the same width that they were before, and even brought some down in some of the widths, so calming the traffic and everything. So that, I think, would have been the biggest thing that people did not like.
Well, you know, and we talk about at this level of government on how people have a say in exactly what's going on. You know, this didn't happen without the input of a lot of citizens. You know, our street and utilities committees, we actually broke it up into two. One that worked on the financing, and now these are just citizens in the city of Moundsview. One group worked on the financing part of it, and the other group worked on the construction part of it. It came to consensus on what we think we should do moving forward. So there was a tremendous amount of input, and continues to be a tremendous amount of input by the residents on our street project. So
do we still have that street and utility committee? Do they still meet? Probably not as often as they used to.
Not as often, because you know this is now our sixth project area coming up, and you know we've kind of got this down pretty good. But no, we still have the street and utilities committee, and it continues to work. They meet a minimum four times a year to work on different parts of the next project that's coming up or the project that's in process. So no, that continues. And then at the end of the last project, what we'll do is we'll disband that committee, and everybody will have new streets.
Well, there's another thing, and of course now that's streets, and to me, when I'm on a street, sometimes I drive a little quickly, and I guess I'm going to make a segue into police.
Okay.
If I ever see a little light behind me,
yeah,
I'm a little worried about that. But when I was reading through the things that have come up, we've got our canine dog, and
correct,
Nico.
Yes.
And Nico is going to get a vest.
Yes.
Which is a great idea, because
yep,
this is a pretty well-trained dog, and
yep,
we put money in Nico.
Yep.
But there's also other vests that are going to be purchased. Is it really $950 for a vest?
For the vest, for the canine unit. And by the way, we are getting that because of a grant. And so I'm not going to say it's free, but a vest is being donated from Nico, and actually it's a nonprofit group. It's called Vested Interest in Canines out of Massachusetts that is doing this nationwide to outfit our canine police officers in vests, because typically, you know, they'll go in with no protection. It's just that, and they provide such a valuable service to the different cities and that have these, they need that level of protection. And so this group out of Massachusetts, as I said, it's a nonprofit group, that's what they do. They raise funds to equip canine dogs with vests. Mm-hmm. Now the vest for the canine dog is $950. Mm-hmm. Typically for a human being, for a vest, we pay anywhere between $700 and $1,100 for a vest. Don't ask me why there's a big difference. It might probably the manufacturer.
So average is $950.
Yeah, so it's about the same for our officers too. And we want to make sure that our officers, all of the equipment that they have is state-of-the-art, up to date, because you know they provide such a valuable service to the residents of the city of Moundsview, and quite frankly, we all know they truly do put their lives on the line every single day that they go out there, and they deserve the best equipment that the city can provide to them.
Well, I noticed too that there's three new going to be hirees. Did we lose some of our officers due to just attrition, retirement? How come we had three openings?
We have three openings. We had two officers that moved to different agencies, my understanding is close to their homes. And then an officer actually retired after 28 mm-hmm. years. Officer Nelson retired. So
oh, he did.
Yeah. So now he's enjoying the retired life, uh-huh, and at least we hope he is.
He was too young. Boy, I'm thinking, my gosh, I remember him coming to my house when I had a raccoon that came inside.
Sure, but you know,
he's leaving.
He faithfully served the residents of Moundsview for 28 years, and yes, our everlasting gratitude for his sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And hopefully, Bob, if you're watching this, you're enjoying your retirement. you know, as it is, so you don't have to get up and do that everyday grind of being a police officer. It's unfortunate that we had three people leave all pretty quickly, but we are satisfied with the candidates that we have chosen coming in. Now, Police Chief Kenny has the job of getting them trained, yes, and he assures us that the training will go smooth, and the three candidates are very good officers for us to have come into the
city. And they've had experience in other ones?
One of them has had previous experience of one type of enforcement, law enforcement, mm-hmm, or security, and two of them two have the experience. One is basically a rookie that's mm-hmm coming in. So
well, I bet he's excited about having a job interview, because that has to be a pretty competitive thing to try.
And I know Tom runs a pretty Police Chief Kinney runs a pretty tight ship back there, and they're going to be put through their paces. We can guarantee that. So.
Well, are we still staying at the same number, total number of officers, and then we have the police chief?
We are. We have 19 sworn officers within the city, and right now we will be at that level of 19. So we did increase the force, but we made sure that we stayed where we need to be at to effectively police the city for the residents.
So the 19, you said we did increase the force, but hasn't it been 19 for a couple of years?
It has been. It's been 19 for
3-4 years?
Yeah, at least.
Something like that.
Correct.
And on top of that, we have 3 new cars we're going to get.
Yes.
I just saw out there some pretty brand new looking ones already.
This gets back to providing our officers with the best possible equipment. We are on a 5-year rotation for our patrol cars. And we've got some older patrol cars that have been out there. What I know, we've got a 2008 and 2009 Crown Vicks that we are retiring, or I should say, sending to the auction block. But that ensures our officers that they've got the best possible equipment, on the roads and that. But yeah, we have been budgeted for 3 squad cars this year. And what we typically do is after the 5 years, those typically kind of go into a lesser role, a non-patrolling role for a few years. But eventually they get to be so old and they've got so many miles on it that we do need to replace them. So
because you said one was a 2009, so it's not quite at 5 years.
Well,
yet.
2008, and then
Yeah, okay.
And actually we've got a couple at 2008, and then a 2009 that we are replacing this year.
But does that then go into this lesser category that's still used
Correct.
Here before it goes on the auction block?
Correct. And those are cars that are used for example, officers if they need to testify in a court case or something like that, and they've got to go down to the city of St. Paul or something like that, as opposed to taking their squad car or whatever, or patrol car, they'll take one of these cars. Other things, meetings, training that they go to. Typically, we want the patrol cars to be here within the city to be used by the officers that are here. We've got a use for them. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, I saw some white ones. I think I've read where people, different cities, are going back to the old-fashioned sort of black. Are we doing that in this case?
Oh yes, we are. We are. As a matter of fact, I believe it was 2 or 3 years ago. We had decided to go back to the black and white.
Right.
Number one, we felt that it is much more noticeable.
I agree with you. And if I'm out doing too fast, I want
to know
where the black and whites are.
Well, just the identification. If people they know a black and white when they see one. It's been staple colors for patrol vehicles for forever.
Yeah.
So we're using the black and whites.
That's what I was wondering.
But they're cycling through as the 5-year cycle goes through. So you'll see some of the older squads will still have the yellow
the
and green.
Sort of blue and yellow color on
the yellow and green markings and that. But any subsequent cars now won't be the black and white.
Uh-huh. And our budget, isn't it like the city's budget? Like 50% is pretty much going to the police force,
Yeah, the police department is about 50% of our budget.
That hasn't changed.
And that has not changed for many years, but it's also the largest staff department that we have within the city, too. So
I know it is. I know that you've investigated about doing it through Ramsey County, et cetera, which are our communities that have done it. And so I won't get into all that.
They have, and we have talked about it being on the council over the years and that. It's been talked about, but you know what? Every time we bring it up, we get a packed house at a council meeting, and the residents are saying, no, we like the idea of having our own police department. They're very protective of their police department. And, it also, we kind of did a cost analysis, and we wouldn't save that much more money if we contracted through Ramsey County or whatever. But the residents do like the idea that it's their police force. So
I have, and that's one reason we do.
Yep.
I noticed that there had been some cancellation of some of our commission meetings this month, And is it like it was economic development and planning commission? Planning commission only met one time, and then you canceled. Is it just because the economy and we aren't really having any economic development? It's been slower. What's some of the
reasons? Well, it has been slow, and it's been picking up. Economic development has been picking up. One of the things that we do on our during our work sessions now, the first Monday of each month, is we've got a standing item, and that is County Highway 10, our corridor on redevelopment. So we talk about it, you know, monthly. But there's no sense, in bringing the EDC in or the Planning Commission in if there's nothing to really talk about. We don't want to have a meeting just to have a meeting.
No.
So.
Well, that's good. That's a wise idea. Yeah. And I'm sure the commission members appreciate it.
And our commission members, they're all volunteer.
Yeah.
And we appreciate their service, and we don't want to use them or when it's not necessary. So, we haven't had any pressing issues or any decision making on economic development for a lot. So there's no sense in bringing them together if it's not necessary.
Now, I know in January you appoint people to various commissions and any vacancies. Do we have vacancies right now on it? You went from 7 to 9 people in the park.
Yes, we went to 7 to 9, and we try and accommodate all people that want to step up and serve the city in that. And we had some wonderful candidates that came forward for Parks Commission. And we wanted to keep all of them. Yeah. And we had our charter said we could only have 7. So we basically asked the Charter Commission to relook and rewrite the charter rules that allow us to have 9 to have those people on that commission. We continue to have openings in some of our other commissions. Our Street and Utilities Committee, as a matter of fact, has openings in it. And if your area has not been done yet, and it's going to be done within the next 3 years, that's a great commission to be on because you will see exactly what's going to happen in your neighborhood. So if you have the time, and like I said, they meet 4 times a year to talk about what's going to happen in your neighborhood, please step forward and volunteer for that one. Yeah. We also have openings in our Charter Commission. We have, I believe, 3 openings in our Charter Commission. And what they do, the Charter Commission, is this is a city run, our charter run city. It's our guiding documents that if there's any questions about what we can do, what we can't do, we always refer back to our charter. Mm-hmm. Very important. We want to make sure our charter is indicative of what is going on today. So it's a fluid document that that the Charter Commission continues to look at and update to make sure that it meets what's going on today and not what was happening in 1979 when our charter was first originated. So
I have a question. If it's going from 7 to 9 on the Park and Recreation, is it also written in there that if there aren't enough applicants that it can still operate on 77?
Yes.
Because that's important.
We have a thing called what constitutes a quorum.
Yeah.
And a quorum is how many members have to be together in order to effectively do business.
But if you go 9... You might 5 is the quorum, and if you have 7, you should only have 4.
Yeah, correct, but it still
it's
stays
stay 5.
Yeah.
Oh, because I know, and I spent years on the Park and Rec and Planning Commission and everything, that's one reason why we went to 7 is because we weren't getting enough people signed up. That was nice flexibility, and if there was something written in there that it could still, slide back to 7. Depending upon what's happening, but you're keeping it at 5 for the
correct
quorum.
As far as what a quorum is considered. Yep.
And then you're doing a compensation study, that is to determine whether our staff is being paid what's a compensatory or is the same thing that you're having in other communities.
Yes, and what that does is you're exactly right, Barbara. Is just to make sure that we are paying our staff members a typical going rate. We want to be in the medium. Now we have a group of cities that best mirror the city of Moundsview, and we compare ourselves to them. We want to stay right in the medium price range. We want to be able to attract the best possible staff members. We want to retain our good staff members. If you do not pay them adequately, they will look elsewhere, and we certainly don't want that to happen. We want to keep our key individuals, and we want to bring in the best people that we possibly can. So we're doing a compensation study. We haven't done one since 2008. To see where we sit in our comparative cities. And when I say comparative cities, a lot of them are around us, the New Brightons, the Arden Hills, the Rosevilles, those types of cities.
You don't look at the population, because we still are smaller than some of the
other communities. Right, right. Well, we also look at Fridley, we look at North St. Paul. So we look at our tax base, based on tax base, it's based on population, it's based on location. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't do us any good to compare a city
to Southwest Minnesota, Minneapolis,
or north of Duluth, yeah, or something like that, just because they happen to have the same number of people that we have. Mm-hmm. So we need to keep it within our geographical area.
So that's something that you're undergoing right now.
Yep.
Now I know this has been going on for a long time. We have that Northern I-35W coalition of all the cities and mayors, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And we've been a member of that for, 10, 15 years? It's been going on for a long time.
Well, no, we opted out of that program back in 2008. It was a budgetary thing, as everybody remembers, 2008, 2009, 2010.
Yeah.
The finances were tough, and we made some cuts in some things that we were doing, and we actually opted out of that coalition back at that time. Now the I-35 corridor coalition has asked us if we want to reconsider getting back in. And what the coalition does, its objective is to look at I-35W and to effect change along there. If you went out and at 7:30 in the morning and you looked at 35W radouts.
On 10, no, you don't want to be there.
Yeah, exactly. Between 10 and Kearney Road I, you don't want to be there. It's virtually a parking lot.
Yes.
You know, the MnDOT dollars have been going towards the west and the south for many, many years.
Absolutely.
And rightfully so. They needed some road work. We need to make sure that our voice is heard, that, you know, we need things in the northern area here too. Mm-hmm. And that's how we affect the funding process, is getting in the, lack of a better word, getting in the face of the people that decide which projects get done in that. Mm-hmm. And that's what that is. So the council is considering opting back in to that coalition, basically to give us a seat at the table when it comes to meeting with our representatives as far as finding funding dollars to help our northern neighborhoods in that.
I know it was very important when we had 610 and connecting, and of course they're doing something now finally over in Brooklyn Center,
yep,
to try to get that road going through, so rather than going down and stopping all the time with stoplights.
Yeah.
So they're doing that. So, I know that is a problem area. And, of course, MnDOT's very aware of it, too. And that's
MnDOT is, yeah. And, you know, it goes back to the old saying, you know, squeaky wheel gets the grease.
Yeah.
And if you're not saying anything, then MnDOT will pay attention to the squeaky wheels. Mm-hmm. So we need to be at that table and in for our interests in the northern suburbs here.
Now, the other thing we're having is a town hall meeting.
Correct, yep.
And that's going to be the 29th of April?
April 29th.
It's Monday night.
Yep, from 6 to 8:30 right here in the council chambers and that, as we've done for the past few years here in the chambers. We used to have it over at the community center, but and we used the banquet room. And the banquet room was so big, you know, and it was fine. We got a really, really nice turnout, but it wasn't intimate. This kind of makes it intimate, and I truly enjoy seeing a packed chamber here as we talk about that. And it's a wonderful opportunity for the residents to come in, find out what's going on in the cities, and we've got displays from all of our different departments here on what's going on.
And Nico will be here, I'm sure.
And Nico will be here also, so they'll be able to meet our canine dog, you know, firsthand and that. So, but that is April 29th from 6 to 8:30. It's a Monday evening. So please plan on attending and come on in and tell us if we're doing a good job or tell us if we're doing a bad job. But that's the time to do it.
And you can meet all the council members and everybody in all the departments.
Yes, all department heads, all council members will be here, and I will be here, and I will be giving the State of the City address, which I do annually at our town hall meeting. That's, if you haven't read it, you know, it was in the Mounds View Matters for the winter edition there, the State of the City. So,
the word always comes up, sustainability. And that's something, I know you had a goal setting thing and everything. So how is Mounds View defining sustainability?
Sustainability, as far as Mounds View is concerned, is to be able to, we need to continually provide the residents with the best possible services from year to year at a reasonable cost to them. Mm-hmm. Sustainability means that we're going to have a continuing flow of whatever it takes and monetarily in order to affect and give the services that the residents deserve. So we try and do that without having to go back to the residents too much and ask for too much money, which we have not had to do. Six of the past 8 years we've had 0% levy increases. And so we've been able to sustain that for, like I said, the past 8 years. And we look at what's going to be happening in the future so we can continue to fund for the residents those types of services. And we look at a lot of things. We've got some TIF parcels that are going to be retiring in the next few years. Now, what happens then when we retire a TIF parcel is all of those properties that are on there now go back on the tax rolls. Mm-hmm. And so instead of us just getting the taxes on the land, we also get the taxes on the structures that are on that land. So that'll be coming. That'll allow us to continue to maintain our levies at a reasonable rate for our residents. So that's kind of how we define what sustainability is not having to go back in an emergency or that ask the residents for additional monies or to do something drastic that's not that we don't do all the time, let's put it that way. Mm-hmm. So consistency, I think, is the best thing.
Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you,
again,
Barbara,
for another conversation with the mayor. Appreciate it. And thank you, everyone, for watching. And again, as I said before, I just hope that we end up having a wonderful spring and summer because it's been a long, hard winter for us.
It has been quite a bit different from last year at this time.
Yes. I guess I don't think we really believe in global warming, do we, with the kind of weather we had this
In Minnesota, we don't. I do that. So.
Anyway, everybody have a wonderful spring. Thank you very much.
Thank you.